What does a poor widow have to do with issues of social justice? We're going to take a look at that. Yes, we're going to see what Jesus was talking about and the issues we're encountering today. Joining us, my son, Chris. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and there's much more. What does the issue of social justice have to do with a poor widow that kept on asking? Luke chapter 18. Chris, how would you respond to that?
Well, let's look at Luke 18, 1 through 8 first, and just see that this parable that Jesus tells of a woman who is a widow and of an unjust judge who doesn't either fear God or respect persons. It has a lot to say to us about really who God is and really how powerful our prayers are. And in turn, by looking at the power that God gives us through our prayers when we're seeking to be obedient and follow the will of God, we can see that in effect, we can see a reordering of our whole environment and that really affects the justice issues, social justice in particular. But in this case, it says that Jesus said, in a certain town, there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. In our own day, it can be difficult for us to understand who is this widow, because widows at that time, many people don't understand this, but they actually dressed differently. They looked differently, as what we understand culturally. And not just that, but if a woman's husband passed away, she did not inherit the house necessarily. Mm-hmm. So her rights that she had had previously in the family are not there anymore. And this is why, you know, in the book of James, we're told true and perfect religion is this: to care for widows and orphans in their distress. If we can think of an oppressed people during this time within Jewish society in first century Palestine, we're told to look to widows. And so these are people whose backs are up against the wall. They're wall-bruised people. And so Jesus tells us that if we want to understand who God is, we need to look at this oppressed woman and see what she did. And what she did was she didn't give up. It tells us that for some time, even though she went to this judge didn't care. He refused. And finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care about men, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice. I'm reading from Luke 18:5, so that she won't eventually wear me out with her coming. And I believe that what we can learn is that if we're wanting to understand faith, we need to look to this oppressed woman, and we need to understand that she did not give up, even though she knew her status and the status of this judge. She knew that he had the power and that she was powerless. She knew that she was forgotten and that he was the one that people looked to. And the problem I believe we have in our society is that we all want to follow the powerful. We all want to look at our superstars. We want to know what the big names are doing in the press. And we want to follow that power and feel better ourselves. And instead, Jesus tells us that we need to look at this example of an oppressed woman who knew where real power was, and she knew her own status, but she knew how to get help. And what he says is, if this judge who could be worn down by this woman would change his mind, how much more will your Heavenly Father, who is a righteous judge, hear you when you call out? And really, it's an example to me that we need to be people who won't give up, who won't stop working. This is why we don't see change in our society, is we have too many people who give up. They don't go to the polls and vote. They don't go and talk to the right people. They don't seek to even be empowered because they've given up faith. Not just faith in a system, but faith in living itself. Because they're looking to the wrong people to provide them with power. And The real question arises, do you want to be in the state that you're in of just being wall bruised and oppressed, or do you want to rise up? Do you want help?
And to help put this in the context, You're well aware of the battle we're encountering here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Yeah, you see how all we want to do is fulfill the mission that God has given us. And again, the opposition we've encountered from the city. And that's why I'm asking all of you to please pray, pray, and pray some more. We need to have you pray. And also, come on out and join us on March 28th here at the New Life Evangelistic Center at 2 o'clock when we can bring you up to date on that particular case. We can bind together in prayer. We can celebrate the last 40 years of the Lord providing this building at 1411 Locust and rededicate it to another 40 years of service. But we really need you all praying at this time because God is a miracle working God, and it's to Him that we're looking to for the miracles. Now, to put this in the context, what Chris had to say concerning Luke 18 and what some of the things we're facing right now, I'd like to go to Bernie Hayes, and he's going to interview Deborah Gamhill and Ronald Montgomery. And they're going to be talking about some of these particular issues and some of the things we're facing here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Then Chris and I want to come back and take you a little deeper journey into all of this, that we took a look at in Luke 18.
Hi, I'm Bernie Hayes, and today's guests are Deborah Gamble and Ron Montgomery. And we're talking about the support for the New Life Evangelistic Center. Both are public supporters of life in general. And I want to tell me the need that you think, Deborah, Ms. Gamble, for shelters for the homeless.
Well, we've just gone through a very bitter winter, and St. Louis has been unrelenting for a very long time in its weather systems this winter. Bitter cold. And where are people to go if they have no place else to go? So we have to provide. It's the humane thing, it's the right thing to provide some space and clothing and places that are warm and food. Mm-hmm. How do we help these people? It's all down to basics.
Mm-hmm. Ron, how does your heart feel about helping the homeless and especially sheltering those in need? Mm-hmm.
These are my sisters and brothers.
Yeah.
You know, these are my family. These are, many of them are people I grew up with. I'm from St. Louis, and in the 60-some years that I've been around, a lot of these people, you know, there but for the grace of God go I. I've also spent 42 years in the military, and I know a lot of the folks that are on the street are military, ex-military. You know, we come home after being trained to do things that we would never want to do and seeing things that we would never want to see, and we're still adjusting. We're broken.
Yeah.
And some are out here on the streets.
The Public Service Commission of the City of St. Louis wants to reduce the number of people to be sheltered at the New Life Evangelistic Center from 300 to 32. What impact do you think that will have on those seeking shelter, Deb?
I think that's 10% of the people who are being served now. 10%. That's a sad, sad situation, a sad commentary on our concern for our fellow human beings. I'm a little ashamed of that.
Mm-hmm. Ron, Reverend Larry Rice here at the New Life Evangelistic Center has been very active in Ferguson,
mm-hmm.
very active in the Shaw neighborhood where they had protests and so forth. I understand that you have a project about healing St. Louis. What is that?
Ah, yes. Mm-hmm. Let's Heal STL.
Okay.
And that is actually Deborah Gamble's project. She started that right after the unrest up and down Grand Avenue and on North New Florissant Road, as well as West Florissant. Mm-hmm. And she gave me a call and asked me would I work with her on this project that would capture pictures of the board up artwork and write poetry specifically to those particular photographs.
Mm-hmm. And Deborah, tell us about Let's Heal STL. Is that what it's called?
That's what it's called.
Tell us about what should we be talking about?
We should be talking about ways that we can peacefully and effectively change the injustices that have been occurring. Mm-hmm. These are deep-rooted and long-standing. And it's quite serious, of course, the passion that people have around these topics. Still and though, you hope that people can talk to each other respectfully mm-hmm. and listen without shouting and without
yes.
destruction.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I don't want to keep going back and forth. I don't want to break the continuity of what we're talking about. But the people who are making the decisions on closing or taking away the beds from the New Life Evangelistic Center are all they've never visited the center, first of all. They've never been here, none of them. And yet and still they have the best packages. They have the best insurance. They have the best salaries. They have retirement plans. Each of you, I'll ask your comments on, mm-hmm. on that. What do you think about these people?
Well, I think people of privilege are making decisions about the poor. Mm-hmm. And that's not really possible for them to do in, mm-hmm. in the comfort of their own homes. They've never spent a night cold. They've mm-hmm. never not had enough. And how do they possibly judge what's best in this situation without even visiting here?
Mr. Montgomery?
Yeah, I totally agree with Deborah. Mm-hmm. Those with privilege and with a sense of entitlement, their entitlement includes things like not being faced with the reality of poverty, not being faced with the reality of inequality, not being faced with the reality of hunger and being without shelter. That is an issue that we need to address. In spite of their inability to envision that, they should take guidance from people who are actually out here doing the work. Reverend Rice is one of those people. They should be listening.
Mm-hmm. Both of you have extensive backgrounds and varied backgrounds, and you don't have to do what you're doing. You don't have to write this book, Let's Heal STL St. Louis. Ron, you don't have to be out here saying that there's a need for the homeless and the shelter, and especially for veterans. Why do you do this? I'll ask you first, Ron.
Well, if we were in a boat in the middle of the ocean, paddling to the nearest island, regardless of what our nationality, gender, we'd be all paddling together. I'm on the boat. I'm on this ship called Earth. And we all have the same issues. I have a responsibility for my brother. I've done well. Life has treated me well. God has treated me well. I have a responsibility to bless those people who need to be blessed, just as God has blessed me.
Deborah Gamble, same question. You don't have to do this. Why?
I think it's a responsibility that we have to take care of one another, to help each other up when we're having a hard time. We can't live in a cotton ball box, you know, that buffers us from the realities of people who are suffering. I think it speaks poorly of our society as a whole if we don't take care of people who are in need.
Your project, Let's Heal St. Louis, it seems like you're on the same mission as Reverend Larry Rice and the people here who run the New Life Evangelistic Center. What do you hope your book, Let's Heal St. Louis, will accomplish?
I hope that it will create more dialogue. I hope that it will give people hope. I hope that they will look at the art and read the words and feel, as I do, inspired toward better things, connected by our higher selves, moving forward through time, supporting each other rather than tearing each other down. And yes. I'm hoping that it'll be done peacefully.
Ron, Deborah says, seeking our higher selves. Does faith play a part in what you do?
Absolutely.
Your faith? Tell me about it.
Absolutely. Like I say, I've been blessed. God has blessed me in so many ways. I shouldn't be here by all rights. By all rights, I should probably be dead. I've been through so many conflicts, but I'm still here.
That's in the wars.
In the wars.
Sure.
You know, I have never, you know, it's Dad has protected me and kept me from places that would do me physical harm or kill me. I have a responsibility. I am here. Those are my brothers and sisters, and I need to do something to give back.
Mm-hmm. And Deborah, you've been giving back. Like I said earlier, you don't have to. Do you get a sense of enjoyment, a sense of pleasure by giving?
Yes, I do. But I also just felt at the initiation of this, it's not enough to go by and look at these things. It's not enough to think about it and ruminate on it. It called to my inner spirit to do more. And I'm happy because I followed that.
The people who are watching us now, what would you say to them? How would you ask them to get involved?
We would hope that we would find more sponsorship, of course, for the printing of this mm-hmm. book. Mm-hmm. We would hope that they will buy the book when it mm-hmm. comes out. We are going to give proceeds to the Ferguson Youth Initiative, to Reinvest North County, to South Grand, and to support the businesses and the young people in these areas. Mm-hmm. So it's not about Ron and me getting rich. We don't expect that at all, but it would be great. But we would hope that we would be able to fund these organizations and these people who are doing so much original and amazing work in these communities.
And Ron, what would you say about the community at large about getting involved in situations such as Ferguson, South Shore, such as New Life Evangelistic Center?
Everyone has a role to play. Everyone that is able should be doing something. Every little bit helps. It doesn't have to be a lot. Maybe it's just a few dollars. Maybe it's just a few hours of your time. Maybe it's just your intention and prayers. Maybe it's helping to give someone something they don't have, a coat, a blanket, a fan.
Thank you. My guests have been Ronald Montgomery and also Deborah Gamble. I'm Bernie Hayes. Please help us. We need your help and support. Thank you.
Thank you, Bernie, Deborah, Ronald. Thank you for helping us to just put this in perspective for people all over and for individuals in the community to see how critical it is that, yes, we do let our voices be heard, stand up against the injustice that we're facing at this time, realize that God loves all people, old, young, black, white, Hispanic, people of all different walks of life, and the homeless. And out of all the homeless people, out of all the people in the world, Jesus chose to totally identify with the homeless. He said, "Foxes have holes, birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head." And Chris, back to Luke chapter 18, because it's so critical for all the issues that we're facing right now. Verses 1 through 8 here, where we see this unjust judge, and we see the widow in that city, and she came to him saying, "Get justice for me, for my adversary." And he would not for a while, but afterwards he said within himself, "Though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest her continual coming she wearies me." And then the Lord said, "Hear what the unjust judge said, and shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears along with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on earth?" And I think that's the question. Will he really find faith on earth?
Well, I picture this widow, and though it doesn't say there, I picture her following this judge wherever he went. I see her, you know, from the time he got up in the morning, she wouldn't leave him alone. If he went to the market, she was right there with him. If he came to work and she wasn't allowed in the court, she'd wait till the court was over. She wasn't giving up. And the fact of the matter is, for her, everything depended on this. And I think that this is our problem, is very often we don't even understand what faith is here. Because faith is relegated to some philosophical or mystical thing, where it's fine to go and say whatever on Sunday morning, but your real power lies in money here in America. Your real power lies in who you know or who your association is. And, you know, the same was true in Jesus' day. And that's why when he asked this question of judgment, he says, "When the Son of Man returns, will he find faith here?" And the type of faith he's talking about is faith that you stake your life on. Mm-hmm. And this is why, you know, so many of us have stood up. We've marched around City Hall. We've slept in front of City Hall. We've marched around this building. We continue to be open day after day, even in the face of opposition. And why is it? It's because of faith. Not faith in faith, but faith has to have a subject. It's got to have an object, or it's no faith at all. And that faith is in the living God. The living God, the Spirit of God that animates all that we do. And so what I'm saying here is, if your faith is alive, if you really believe in Jesus, if you place your not just, you know, just hope in him, hope and hope, but your hope, your trust, your all in him, if you cling to him, if he is the one who lives in you, then what Jesus said about this widow, what Jesus said about himself, what he said to the rich young ruler, why hasn't that really touched you in your life to where you're really willing to give all? And in a real sense, pray, because what's affecting us affects our entire region. And what I always say is in caring for our homeless brothers and sisters, what we're realizing is that our future is bound up with all of them. It's not just a matter of doing for others. If you think that giving to the homeless or giving this place is just doing for others, then you're missing the picture, because faith is not about tokenism. It's about understanding that if they're coming after us, they're coming after you. It's about understanding that our future is bound up with one another. And what's done to African Americans in our community, what's done to the impoverished in our community, what's done to whites, what's done to Hispanics, in the case of money, it affects every single one of us.
And again, we're broadening the context. We need you to pray for us here at the New Life Evangelistic Center as we desire to live out the mission God has given us. A federal lawsuit has been filed. Please pray for that and the preliminary injunction to stop the city from trying to get us to reduce to 32. This affects every religious organization in America. Do we have the right to practice what we preach? And that's what we're trying to do here. And that's what this lawsuit is all about. So please pray for victory for the New Life Evangelistic Center, for its right to fulfill its mission among the homeless, and your church then will have a legal precedent to fulfill its mission. As we talk about a mission and prayer, I want us to continue to pray. Pray for all this that we saw unfold in Ferguson that also reveals a tremendous need throughout this whole region, the great gulf that exists between our police departments and our young people, where the young people see the police as individuals that go out and hunt bad behavior. The Lord gave a very important program to us, the cop cards, the positive ticketing program, that I believe that as it starts in Moline Acres could spread through the whole region and build a relationship. And that's why I'd like to go now to Kamal and the mayor of Moline Acres as they discuss this. And I'm asking you to pray for New Life Evangelistic Center's victory in the federal lawsuit, and also pray for the positive ticketing program and the positive court that is now coming in, because Moline Acres has encouraged its officers to go out and try to find 7 positive events to issue 7 positive tickets a day. This is really exciting. Let's go to Kamal.
This is Kamal Dockin, and we're at Meadows Elementary School here in Moline Acres, and I'm talking to, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, I can. My name is Michelle Deshay.
Okay.
And I am the mayor of the city of Moline Acres, and as you just said, we are in Meadows School, which is located in the Riverview Garden School District, and we are in Moline Acres.
Okay. And basically, we're here today promoting positive ticketing, and specifically, we're promoting the cop cards. Now, the city is a visionary city. That's one of your statements, that the city of...
City with a vision.
Yes. Okay. And so what is the vision of the positive ticketing and the cop cards?
The vision of the positive ticketing and the cop cards is we want to build a relationship between the community and the police department. We have, in lieu of everything that has happened in North County recently, we are trying to bring any positive program and put it in place. As I see now, we have kind of lacked from community policing. So in the old neighborhood policing, this would bring a sense of bridging that gap to the community.
And basically, and you kind of mentioned this and brought this out, that it's not only the police job, but it's the community's job to help and aid and assist the community, the police department. What would you say to local residents in Moline Acres and throughout the city of St. Louis, the county, about helping and assisting the local municipality, the police officers, and police in the neighborhoods?
I would say that becoming aware of that the police is not out to get you.
Okay.
The police are not out to get you. They're here to help, actually. That all police are not bad. We have great cops. We have great police out here that's trying to help the municipalities and help the communities that they serve. They also took an oath to protect and to serve. And this is what I think that this program will assist with, showing that they're there to protect and to serve the communities.
And right. And then also, too, we have a low number of African-American men and women that's desiring to be police officers. And we feel that the positive ticketing can be a tool to be used to allow that bridge between African-Americans to want to be police officers. I mean, would you encourage African-American young men and women to want to be in law enforcement?
Absolutely. we have all different kind of areas that people can go into for careers. Being an officer is a great thing because you're there to help the community and to see about, just actually just oversee the community and see that everything is running fine and running smooth within the community. So it is a great, this program is a great tool that can be used not only in Moline Acres, throughout the whole throughout all the municipalities within St. Louis County and city, to get back to that old school police.
Okay, and then as the mayor, as the visionary of Moline Acres, what would you like to see your community in years to come, and then also in relation to other municipalities and other cities that surround you working together?
I would like to see the city of Moline Acres. I know that we have a great city,
okay,
and I would like to let everyone else see that the city of Moline Acres is a great city, a great place to live, work, and play.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mayor.
This is so exciting what God is doing through New Life Evangelistic Center as we team up with Emo's Pizza, and they're giving positive tickets starting out at Moline Acres and the positive court there, and it can spread. We're going to bring in other businesses in on this. A very positive solution to break down the barriers that exist between our police officers and people in the community. It can spread all over. We have Brooklyn, Illinois has expressed an interest in this. Venice, Illinois has expressed interest in this. Madison, Illinois, communities in Missouri and over in North County. This is exciting, Chris. People need to be praying for the positive ticketing program and also for the federal lawsuit against the city of St. Louis that's trying to stop us from filling our mission.
And it's really interesting that the places that you're mentioning are small municipalities, mm-hmm, don't have a lot of money themselves, and I believe that that's how God works. The seeds tend to start where people want to look away. You know, those abandoned places of empire, if you will, where essentially, you know, it's not starting with Clayton. Clayton's not wanting to pick it up. City of St. Louis, oh, they're too big, too powerful. Yeah. They don't need to do this kind of thing. But you see the seeds of change really happening in these small communities. They get it. They understand. They've got a small police force. They have smaller neighborhoods. They can see the impact it has with just, you know, talking to these kids and reaching out and get to know them.
And it's so positive. I mean, compare that to city of St. Louis, that the worse the crime gets and the more the mayor appeals to taxpayers, get them $8 million in tax funds to hire 160 more police officers. It almost feeds itself. The worse it gets in the city, the more police that they can get. And they want to create a police state. But in these small communities like this, we're taking them one by one, developing the cop card program, the positive ticketing program, the positive court program, and we need your prayers at this particular time because God is a miracle-working God, and there's just so many things that He is doing as a result of you being that persistent widow, you being that persistent prayer warrior. Jesus said, whatever you ask here on earth, what two or three agree on earth, it's agreed upon in heaven. Bind, pray, and knock on those doors. Keep on binding and loosening the keys of the kingdom in the name of Jesus.
Amen. That's so right. And really, prayer is where the real action is, where it happens. And oftentimes we think of prayer as something that we do on the side. But without prayer, we can't keep going every day. Our whole life is meant to be a life of prayer. That's why this in the case of the persistent widow, it's clear that she wasn't just talking to the judge, but there was action behind this. The judge couldn't help but listen. And what Jesus is telling us is with your whole life, live it for God. Don't stop in such a way that you, because you know that you have a righteous judge who's acting in your behalf speedily. And this is this is why all of our actions have to be for God. Not only that, we have to understand that everything He gives us, even if it seems like a setback, is going to be for His glory.
He says, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Keep on asking. Keep on knocking. Keep on praying. Continue to pray for New Life Evangelistic Center and this federal lawsuit against the oppressive activities of the city of St. Louis, trying to press not only this work, but churches all over from living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. Continue to pray for the positive ticketing program as it begins to spread throughout communities, changing the way policing is done, building relationships for the glory of God. For further information on all of this, go to www.newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. And I thank God for those of you that continue to pray and persist in your prayers on a daily basis.